reader in Brisbane, Chris Morris.
Champion. Hello, everyone. Thank you for having me. Thank you, James, Kim, ACMI, for all of this, and all of you guys for coming. I grew up in Perth, so we didn't have any events like this. Whenever I come to these things, I'm always blown away at sort of all the networking and how much you can learn and all this great shit. It's awesome. Forgive me, I've got like a cheat sheet here. I will just rant if I didn't have this with me, so it's sort of like a security thing for everyone. So I'm from Breeder. We're a design-led studio up in Brisbane. We like to do title sequences when we can, stuff like that. We feel like it's the most sort of creative journeys or whatever. That's our logo. My background's kind of in live action. I was a bit of an After Effects kind of individual when I was younger. And then I enjoyed cameras and these things, but I was always very interested in After Effects. And actually became like a camera person, so to speak, and then sort of came back into animation professionally at some point. But I still sort of look to live action quite a lot in my work to make things interesting and to have more fun. And I take a lot of my inspirations from photography, stuff like that. I'm really into sort of props, real life objects, real physical things that you sort of pull off some sort of in-camera gag. I love like YouTubes about maths and physics and all that sort of stuff. So some of my inspiration probably comes from that. I don't have a reel to show, but I've chuck together an edit of like a bunch of stuff that we've worked on or contributed to over the last few years. And it's all stuff that sort of has a live action foundation to it, you might say. And there's some cheeky planets as well because I ran out of time. Gracias. I don't know if you noticed, there's a fair bit of live action in there. Like, there's quite a few shots that actually haven't been augmented at all. And that's sort of something I'm going to try and talk to a little bit about today. And it's something, again, that I'm quite interested in. So we have a sister company, called Joseph Mark. There we go. They're awesome. There's about 20 of them or so. They've got a bunch of developers, designers, copywriters. And while Breed is a tiny entity, really, when we have to write a script or something, we can pull in one of their copywriters. If we need more designers, we just drag people out of... They're all working on websites and shit they don't want to do anyway, so it's awesome. But again, like being able to expand on all these things is pretty important to us. And another thing that they did is they actually built a daily inspiration blog, which I'll bang on about later on, called Good Moves. And disclaimer, these are just my opinions. Honestly, I don't really know what I'm talking about here. I actually look up to the majority of you guys in this room, so yeah, there's that. So the first thing I wanted to speak to was exploration versus execution. This is one of my favorite logics. It's kind of the idea that you begin projects with exploration and then you end them with execution, really. I'm very interested in how these two things can overlap when doing a project as well. It does depend on your client. Like, you know, you can't just take a client's money and then say, we'll come back with something, it'll be fantastic. But sometimes you can, and if they're really cool, they let you do it, and it means that you actually don't have to lock yourself into anything possibly to begin with. As long as the client trusts the team and the creative enough, you can go down these scary journeys of basically discovering discovering a product or a project, so to speak. I'd argue that everyone's got bread and butter projects and projects where at the beginning you can see the finish line, you know how you're going to get there. But I'd argue the majority of us are probably more interested in projects where there's some sort of unknown, there's something to be discovered, there's something new. Like, we all want a challenge here, we're all makers. No one wants to just punch out the same thing again with just a different setting on it. So I'm going to show another project here. This is sort of an example of how your creative, your execution and your exploration can overlap a little bit. This clip's got like a minute of just ungraded raw stuff off the camera, and then at the end it's got the 15-second sequence. But I wanted to play it just to show you guys sort of how we just go shoot a bunch of content, have some ideas in mind, have a bit of a plan, but then again, like, leave it really, really open for ourselves to discover later on. Footage just to make that little thing at the end, eh? Too far. Okay, never mind. So it was a little title sequence for the World Economic Forum, and they made a documentary called the Fourth Industrial, Fourth Industrial Revolution or something or other. It's about humans becoming robots. It's awesome. Go click it. It's great. Blah, blah, blah. That was actually all shot on a Sony A7S II, which I think is that camera body over there. It's the fucking business. Really good for low light. Has a lot of rolling shutter problems. And it weighs so little that a lot of jitter can come into the sensor. And that actually came across a lot in that footage, but yeah, whatever. It's an amazing camera. It really is. Like, if any of you guys are thinking about going and getting a sensor for you guys to shoot some footage for you to fiddle with, like, it's like the 5D. Like, when the 5D came out, everyone freaked out, depth of field, and it was like a paradigm shift in the kind of images you can make with a sort of a cheap camera. And to some extent, I'd argue that body is somewhat similar. 4K, 2K, 120 frames. It's really brilliant. About $4,000. And you get little adapters on them, and then you stick all your Canon lenses onto them. Incredible. Sony should sponsor this event, probably. And again, like, sort of, we shot all the footage for that. We had some ideas about what we wanted to fiddle with and maybe play with afterwards, but it's one of these examples where we had total freedom, and so we just went, greased up a chick with a coconut oil and made her all shiny, and then that's actually architectural lighting called Neon Flex, which is the coolest lights you've ever seen in your life. It's this sort of, comes in giant rolls. It's the stuff that you'll see along the sides of buildings, so it's waterproof, doesn't flicker. And all we did was just strap some panels of it to some coat hangers and then hung them from pulleys and just manhandled it up and down. And you get all that lovely light play and stuff, and she looks a bit like a product and whatnot. And so we actually took a similar approach on this next project. This next project was basically just a test case for us. It was a love project. It was sort of a collaboration between us and Tasty, which is a company I'll speak about in a moment. They're a production company. And there is no premise to this thing, hey? Like, there's no story. This is just us trying to get some images out and then have a fiddle with it afterwards. And we just wanted to maybe try and create a feeling or something. It's Mabo. It's a feeling. And all this audio is by Alabaster, by the way. Now this next thing, so this is what we shot that last project on. And this is the showreel for Tasty, so they've done some TV adverts and food and all this sort of stuff. They've basically got two MoCo high-speed motion control robots. I think they're the only people in the Southern Hemisphere with the double setup, and they're looking to basically facilitate all sort of Asia's demands for cereal adverts and stuff like that. But this is the thing, like, people only do fucking food shots with these things. Like, it's only ever food, and fair enough, because it looks amazing, but they're keen to have people come in and drop ink into water or something, I guess, because it's kind of a bit repetitive, the things that they do. So that last, that's the reel or whatever. The last thing was, effectively, it was a cinematics piece. Cinematics? Someone knows the answer to that. So it's basically a speaker running some frequencies with a petri dish on top, and then you stick some glucose in some water, it rattles around, and then it does pretty shapes. And we did. We went in there, we just shot a bunch of random content, we had some ideas, we knew we wanted to get a shot of a drop of water falling in camera for realsies. And again, like, a lot of that spot that you saw, like at the end when it was all mirrored and whatever, is obviously some sort of comp, but about half that spot is just slightly edited, repositioned footage, like regular footage. And it's cool, you know, you strip away all the unnecessities in the image and it kind of sometimes looks a bit like a render. It can look a bit more interesting, I think. And here's some stills. So, these guys are Tasty up in Queensland. Brendan and Steve Isaac run the place. That's Steve. Very talented, very lovely gentleman. They've got lighting trucks. They've got everything you can imagine for image acquisition. They're totally across it. They're also tremendously lovely people. They don't mind you setting fire to things in their studio next to a $1 million robot. Like, they do things that you would imagine you wouldn't normally, the industry wouldn't normally let you do that sort of stuff. They're really cool guys. And so that's a Phantom Flex camera that's shooting 1600 frames at 2.5K, and it's all with a global shutter as well, so you'll never have jello, you'll never have any issues. And they're called Fred and Barney, which is kind of cool, I guess. And then that's some cool app for doing like little frequencies if anyone wants to do speaker stuff, audio tests. Another thing to note too is this is industry hardware, so they do kill people. They've got stop buttons everywhere, and you just can't really go near the machines. Like, it's a very weird, surreal thing where you're in this big space and there's robots moving around, and something happens over about half a second, and then suddenly you realize you've got 40 seconds of footage that you've got to review now, or you've got to download it. And it takes ages to deal with it. And all the files that come out of Phantoms are pretty hectic too. The Cine files are massive. So reel for fake. One thing we've been lucky to explore with Tasty is the idea of reel for fake. You know how everyone's rendered something out and thought, that looks pretty fucking real. And then they show it to someone and they're like, oh my God, that's a real thing that you've just done. I get a kick out of the opposite, where if you can get something in camera, but it's so removed from reality that it comes off like a render. I love that stuff, you know, and I feel like it's a little bit like design in general, right? You're about stripping away the unnecessities and presenting people with a central core idea or a silhouette or whatever it may be. And that's why everything I do is on black. There's never a background. It's all pretty straightforward. And then I've got one more from the robots to show. This is that shoe thingo. Yeah, the client wanted paint hitting shoes and they didn't really care what happened as long as some paint hit some shoes. So this is another example where we went in there with some shoes and some paint and we said to them, like, this is natural phenomena with robots. You've got no chance of getting exactly what you want, but if you trust us, we'll get something going for you. And it was a fun thing to do. It wasn't actually a lot of stress, that project, just because we set the client up with that expectation of, you know, this is going to be really tricky to get anything near like what you could imagine. So you're going to have to wait to see how we go. And then from there, we'll move ahead. Again, like most of it was in camera. It's effectively, here we go. So what we did is we jammed some holes in some shoes and then rammed a rod at the back of it and mounted that to the model mover Barney. And you can see him there. He sort of twirls and goes up. And then there's a little like actuated trigger thing that hits a balloon of paint and then it drops the paint down onto Barney, who like spears it basically. And you can see there's a fair bit of roto and things to like paint out. Actually, that's not true. There wasn't much roto. One thing we did was we went full Star Wars with it and lit the background bright white, kept the shoe completely black, and then just shot luma passes for all the shoes. And so we didn't actually have to do any roto, apart from painting out the shoe rig, like the stuff that's inside the shoe. We didn't do any roto. It's fucking genius, right? It's incredible. And like, it took us 20 seconds. We're there on the day, and we're like, all right, you know what? Let's just quickly do this because it might be worth having a mat of this. And it's not very often that you get to film anything and you actually get to create a mat for it. Like, all you 3D heads right now are thinking, oh, it's object buffer, bro, object buffer. Like, you just click that tag. You don't get, unless you've got MoCo, you can't do any of that stuff, right? So, yeah, we wanted to basically hit these shoes with paint. We only had, like, 8 or 10 single shoes to work with. So, like, we only had so many goes at this thing. And one of the times, actually, the trigger just went really impotent and just tapped the sack of paint. And it just started oozing out little drips of paint onto the shoe. And we were all freaked out running in thinking, you know, we only got so many goes at this. But in the end, we only had to trash like 5 or 6 shoes, which was really good. Good project. Very stressful. Well, not super stressful, but a bit weird being around that equipment. It's very, very slow to work with that stuff. Like, you'd only get 1 to 4 shots done a day doing that sort of thing. It's very strange. It's a bit like, honestly, it's a bit like running a sim in a computer. Like if you were doing some real flow thing or something. You sort of set up your parameters. You set up the move, you design the camera, you light it, set up your triggering system, test a couple of variables with the triggering system, like, oh, does it have a bit of air pressure in there, or how high off the shoes is it? And then you sort of just click run, you just kind of go, and it's hands off, like, it's not like you're animating, it's completely procedural. It's reality is just rendering that out for you in real time. And it's accurate down to the atom, like you can zoom as far as you want. You can't repeat any of it technically because the paint always does something else. But most importantly, the clients can't come back with revisions. You know, when you do something like this, that's getting done, like that's it. If they wanted it to be, like there's no changing it, which I love. They're kind of like locked in. Oh, there you go. This is it spinning around. I should show you this. Seconds after this was filmed, that snapped in half and started spinning around in a very dangerous manner because we tried to fix it with like a splint from a knife or something. Super dodgy. Don't tell anyone about this. And then that's basically it. You can see Brendan's in the background there. He's got a desk. It's running, I think it's Unix or something. I forget. And it's PC for all the Phantom stuff. You can't use Macs. So there you go. That's the old mate sitting on a rod. Barney's sort of holding him. We had to cover Barney in a whole bunch of protection. You can see the Phantom up on Fred. Mystery box. Has anyone heard of the mystery box? It's a thing that J.J. Abrams bangs on about a bit. It kind of basically sort of says that audiences love to be teased. We love to think like, you know, how was that done or what's going to happen? Why haven't I seen the monster yet? You know, we all get drawn into this idea of like we imagine it for ourselves, you might say. I love the idea of the mystery box. I think it was used a fair bit on Lost and I think they stuffed that up because they got to the last season and they realized they'd created so much mystery they couldn't resolve any of it. And so they just made it purgatory or whatever the hell happened. So it didn't work there, but I believe in mystery box. I think it's a cool idea. I think it relates to cinema as well. A lot of people know that, like, if you watch Ang Lee, I think it is, has just done a 4K stereo 120 frames a second film, right? Has anyone heard this? And apparently it's so real, humans can't handle it. It's so much, it's so much you just can't deal with it. People want 24 frames, they want grain, they want to actually see less and just fill in the blanks themselves, I think, a little bit. And for me, that applies to motion as well. Like whenever I see a gag, a technique, or an aesthetic, or anything that comes along and you say to yourself, I have no idea how they executed that, I love it. I think it's amazing. Often a lot of these gags come through in 3D renders and it just comes down to some crazy Python or something. And then for me, it's Python, you know. But when I see people pull together like hacky sort of live action-y things and practical effects, I get quite excited generally. Mystery Box, pitchin' is bitchin'. I don't think there's much I can add to pitching after your talk, my dear, this morning. I'm not a fan of pitching. It kind of sucks. One thing we do at work is we actually make them a website when we do it. It's like a WordPress random thing that my clever colleagues have set up. And then instead of putting together a PDF or something, or rather we make this website with parallax and all the guff. And then they can go and scroll through that, which is cool. I don't know if it works well or not. It's cool. I'm not a huge fan of pitching. We don't work with agencies much. We pretty much always direct a client, and often they're in the US. One thing I will say about pitching is I do think it helps to have a differentiator as an individual or as an entity. It pays to have a style. It pays to have something that you do really well. You should be very versatile in all these things, but like, it does pay that if you can nail something quite well, because you know when a client comes to you, you can say, look, like we're the best at this, hey? You shouldn't go anywhere else because we're going to charge you good money because clearly this is our avenue, this is our style, this is the thing that we do best in the country. And I don't think a lot of people do that, but you do hear about certain artists who have certain styles, especially illustrators, where everyone always goes to them for that work because they know that that individual is the person to do the job. I guess animation's different, it's pretty broad and all these things, but I wouldn't take on some hectic 3D project because it's just not my bag. But if someone wanted to cheat something in camera or do some fun gag, you know, I'm quite interested. There is a book, I believe it's called Win Without Pitching. Has anyone read that book? Blends. Makes you pretty cocky when you read it. Like, it tells you to just walk out there and demand things from the universe. Like, it's something, hey? And like, a few of the things he says, I don't know, but then there's some other things he says which I think are incredible. He talks about sort of graphing your value, and he uses the analogy of a doctor where, you know, when you go to a doctor, he doesn't diagnose your problem and prescribe like a solution. You know, that's a pitch. A pitch is you're fixing this person's problem and you're giving them your idea for free. And then if you go to the doctor and he gives you all this information and you say, okay, well, I'll pay you when I get my prescription, like it's ridiculous, right? And I do feel that way about pitches sometimes as well. I feel like it sucks that so many people break their backs putting like the most creative idea out there, and then for all I know that entity could go take that idea and fiddle with it and take it over to another place and all these other things. So I think it's a good book, you should probably read it. The idea of this graph, I thought it was fascinating, because he also talks about how, you know, your highest value is at the beginning, and technically as time passes, it's like a service agreement, you're just amending text, and like as time passes you actually have less value to them. Anyone else can amend that project for them possibly. Whereas we treat it the other way. We all act like we're free and it's awesome to begin with. And then as time passes, we're all going to make more money. It's going to be fantastic. So I think it's backwards, but I don't know. What else we got here? Gags. Gags. For me, you know, a fun project has a unique gag. It could be anything. It could be the aesthetics, the technical. It could be the approach. It could be the story. Something about it should be new and fun, I think. You want that newness, I think. I think also over the last sort of 10 to 15 years, the populace's visual maturity has definitely changed. Like, our expectations now from visual mediums is just off the chain. You know, think about how disappointed you would be if there wasn't, like, everyone getting stabbed at a wedding at the end of a Game of Thrones season. Like, the level of story that they've got to hit and shock, the level of sort of visual expectation that everyone has now, it's just crazy. It's very difficult to sort of keep up with that, I think, you know, and there's so much stuff happening on the internet that it's even hard to know where you stand in all of this. Like, you can come up with a great idea and a week later, someone else has done it, you know? It's crazy. One other thing I want to show now is a breakdown from a really old project, and I'm not going to show the project, but it's a good example of sort of how you can get away with hacking your way through something, and if you plan your hack, you can sort of, I don't know, basically get away with more than you should be able to get away with. So this project is, what am I saying here? So this is from a couple of years ago. You can see that it's basically a girl dancing, and we've just tracked her skin pores and then just puppeted a bunch of textures around and jammed it on her. in the end, you look at the end render and it seems like there's more going on. Like you feel like there's some parallax. It feels like maybe there's something fancier there, but really it's not. It's just all just 2D stuff moving around. And I love projects like this, you know. I think a lot of other people would come at this thing probably looking to, well, maybe even dimensionalize her, do a whole bunch of stuff, you know. And the reality is if you sort of plan your hack and you're really cheeky and cheap about it, you can get it done quite easy. And again, like it's curious to see how in this, how much of her motion as a human is effectively sort of driving her movements. I really like that. So I really do enjoy the melding of live action and motion. For me, I think it's the, for me at least, it's the best way forward. I don't ever see myself being like an incredible 3D person. There's so many incredible 3D individuals here in this room that I'd rather just hook up with one of you guys and ask you to help out on a project, basically. I sort of feel like it's one of those crafts that if you're over 30, it can be pretty hard to get into it and find time away from your family to get all these things done. And yeah, I probably should do better. And I've tried learning cinema, but I'm never going to catch up with everyone else. That's the way I feel, at least. I love live action. I love humans and motion. I think it's got something to do with, I don't know, I think people love to see humans in the frame. We're obsessed with seeing humans and stories and things. You know, using live action footage or stills of humans as a canvas to work upon, I think it's a great starting point. You know, it takes really very little effort to own the audience's attention. As soon as you see a person in frame, you're kind of interested to see what's going on. And it's the same with sort of macro eyeballs, people inhaling, like all these sort of motifs I try to repeat in our projects as much as possible. I think it's good in that you want to get humans in the frame. You want to, I don't know, have some calling cards maybe. But the main reason is actually something that Fincher says.
I think people are perverts. I've maintained that. That's the foundation of my career.
God bless you, Fincher. Champion. And it's true. I think, like, no, well, we're kind of all tall bonobos, people. Like, when you're walking down the street, you're weighing everyone up. You're thinking, is this person a threat? Is this person really sexy? You know, I don't know. And I think seeing humans in the frame, it's a very potent thing. It's very potent. Anyways, so I've got one final clip to show. Oh, I'm 30 minutes. And this is basically just another breakdown of another project. It doesn't really need any explaining. It's an interesting example, you might say, of using live action amongst a bunch of design elements. Just quickly, we're going to powerhouse through some hot tips. Get started. Just get started, people. Stop stuffing around. Just get in there. Literally, it's procrastination. You all know about it. Learn the rules so you can break them. Try and identify trends and try to mess with those trends. Do whatever you can to like be original with it. If you can, be your best. Mad gains, then cut the fat. This is something I've learned in the last few years, which is basically, you know, dial it to 11T. Just go nuts with it and then bring it back. Like if you sit there edging forward and you're a designer and you know, you're better off just going way too far and then stepping back a little bit. Seems to help, at least for me. Zone out. I love daydreaming and zoning out, things like that. Tends to work well. And this one I've heard recently, which I quite like, which is thinking you suck is a great thing. And it's true, you know, like if you think everything that you're making is fantastic, then it shows that if you think everything you make sucks, it means that your taste outweighs your ability. Does that make sense? Mm-hmm. I think it's a great way to look at it. I really love that one. We're nearly there, dudes, don't worry. And so this is our little inspiration blog I quickly want to talk about. It's called goodmoves.tv. Basically, we just jammed all of you guys' Vimeos into some back-end jazz that they wrote. And then that scrapes all your Vimeo likes. And then we go through all that most days or every day. And then we post something that we like. So it's curated, but to a large extent, a lot of the groundwork's done for us. And there's some pretty good stuff on there. It's also kind of, there's an Apple TV app and there's an iPhone app as well. So totally free. Oh, there you go. Goodmoves.tv. And then the last thing would be hit us up. Thank you.
Thanks, Chris. Chris Morris from Breeder. Great stuff.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, everyone, for listening.
Yeah, thank you. Stick around for questions. Certainly. Has anyone got questions for Chris?
Chris, thank you so much. I really enjoyed your talk because I love live action too. Really? I love to call it organic pixels, my favourite thing to work with.
Oh, really? Meat puppets. I've been calling people meat puppets lately.
My question is about grading. And you're obviously working with footage a lot. Are you guys working with colorists to grade, or are you starting to work with DaVinci yourselves?
One of my colleagues has a bit of DaVinci-ness just on the laptop and stuff. If the budget's there, we've learned to just take it to a bigger studio that has a suite and all the business and just pay insane amounts of money to them. And they just they elevate the image, no end. I'm an After Effects dude, so I just want to get it done in there. I reckon I can get it done with curves, you know, but the reality is that's not the case, eh? Like, it's incredible when you take something to a professional grade, like what it does to the job. It's the same as audio, I guess. Like, and we don't do any audio stuff. We leave it up to other people.
Mark. Just wanted to know how organic your shoot process was, or if you really sort of went to town with organizing.
Well, this is part of the thing. Like, you know, when I go into live action shoots, I engineer it so that I've always got backup plans. Like, there's multiple options no matter what happens. And usually what happens is you go in there and you don't know if something's going to work. You don't know how many shoes the client's going to give you. There's so many variables. So I effectively never go into a shoot thinking I've got it dialed in and it's just everything's just going to fall into the schedule. Like, it's imperative, at least for me, it's imperative that it's like you could freestyle the day in its entirety if you had to. And you effectively just start coming up with all these quantum possibilities of what happens when throughout the day. And if that's the case, what would you do? And again, it's tricky. Like, with the robots, it's a bit of a nightmare. Like, you do have to have a plan with them. Just not having an adapter or something can kind of screw the project.
Really cool stuff, by the way. How did you... what was your sort of career progression as to how you ended up in this really cool space, sort of producing stuff where clients will just let you do your thing?
I started out making wedding videos, eh? Like... Well, that's not true. Like, I was smashing Photoshop and whatever when I was a kid, and I always got into animation, but I was in Perth. But anyone who's from Perth knows that there's no motion meetup over there. Like, in the, you know, 10, 15 years ago, I was using After Effects about 5 or 6 years before I actually met anyone else who knew what it was. And then, like, I did the whole camera route, tried to earn money that way. I actually worked at factories for a while, spent a lot of time just because I was an idiot or something. I never went to uni or anything, and I ended up doing blue collar. And after a few years of that, I spent all my days thinking about the animation I was going to make when I went home. And so it's always been the passion thing in the background. But then I'm just lucky in that. Well, 5 years ago, I started in at Breeder in Brisbane. And they're sort of open to this sort of stuff and weird creativity in that. Mind you, before Breeder, I was working at a lot of architectural previs 3D companies around Europe and stuff. So all my mentors were like hardcore 3D heads, all Max Mayer dudes. And, you know, I came to Brisbane with this weird sort of, you know, naming conventions are important, like all this really anal kind of like, you know, draftsmanship style kind of logic. And then something I've learned over the last few years is, you know, when you're trying to come up with a funky image, you're better off just making 20 funky images and one of them might be okay. Like, if you sit there naming layers and getting really anal in that exploration part of the process, you're boned. And I did it for years. Looking back, I know that I've wasted months of my life, literally months, doing really naff things like that, you know? But in answer to your question, I think it's luck. It really is luck. And a part of my job at work as well is, I'd argue, is possibly more creative problem solving than animating or camera operating or DPing or anything. Like, it's generally, I try to come at it from a very, maybe more from a practical or VFX soup kind of angle, like try to understand all the components that come together to make something happen and effectively look for shortcuts and hacks, and then always look for, I'd argue, always look for opportunities in your team or with props or anything. You know, if you've got something at hand, if you've got a friend who's got an awesome car, you know, like, try and use that in a project or something. Like milk any avenue that you can for those sorts of things.
Thank you.
Oh, cheers.
So what's... Shut up. Yeah, he'd had enough. What's the Brisbane motion graphics scene like now that you've moved from Perth and there wasn't much there? What's Brisbane like? Or the filmmaking?
Brisbane's got a lot of bigger, like Post Lounge, Cutting Edge, Alt. Like both Cutting Edge and Alt, I think, came out of Brisbane and now they're here, right?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, it's curious. Yeah. So there's a good VFX kind of set down there and they're like really talented companies. When it comes to motion, I'm not across a lot of it. There's some of my friends are up there. Jenny and Paul actually just moved down from Brisbane. I think they were probably the most talented individuals in Brisbane until they moved down here, sadly. But I don't know enough people. Like, I'm the worst. Like, I'm the worst. I don't network. I don't watch stuff on the... Like, I don't even watch much motion on the internet.
Really? You don't contribute to the Good Moves website?
Oh, you know, I will, but, like, I don't actually go out of my way. I won't go home and watch animations anymore. Sure. I'll go through photo blogs generally and look at photography stuff.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
I guess that's more suitable to the live action...
A little bit.
...influence, yeah.
Yeah.
Any more questions from the audience?
Just on that, do you think that there's too many people looking at reference? And is there, like, because I find that a lot of work looks the same. And yeah, do you think that looking at reference is actually becoming a bit of a problem or a bad thing?
I have no idea. I reckon reference is probably paramount to everything. Like, you do see individuals, like one of the guys I work with, Ryan McShane, he draws crazy stuff. And I don't know if he's being inspired by other people, but I would argue that maybe if he looked at too much other people's work, he might lose some of his own unique identity. Because he's a very interesting illustrator. He's very, very unique, I think. When it comes to people referencing for motion and high-end 3D motion-y sorts of things, I guess it's hard to say with trends. Like, they come and they go. I guess they'll come back around again. I always look for reference just so I can say, oh, look, it's the high-density, low-value pixels hanging around that element over there that make it feel more organic to me. And that stuff only occurs to me when I sit there, like, studying kind of the components of an image that I like. Like, I really sit there and pixel fuck it and say to myself, what are all the components of this image, you know? And I'd recommend, who's seen Division 5, Carey's shoots?
Agreed.
They are the best tutorials on the internet, let's face it. Like, Motionographer is awesome, but you guys can just go watch this guy's 5 tutorials. You can all quit uni and just roll it out. Like, the things he talks about, I've print screened that stuff and I keep it on a folder to reference. All the things he talks about are brilliant. And he talks about reference quite a bit. And he's probably right, so I can do that.
I second that. Division 5. Oh. Write it down, Google it. 5 free tutorials. I think he's got a 6th one that you pay for. It's worth it. Worth it too. Snapdragon, yeah, really good. Any more questions for Chris? If not, all silent, all done. Sold. Chris Morris.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you. Good job.
Thanks, guys.